Computer. We'll give maybe a couple more minutes, maybe. I like to start on time.
Yeah.
Okay, I have 2 minutes after the hour of 12. I'm going to stop sharing this. And bring this down.
Melanie?
Yeah.
Hey there, good afternoon.
Hey,
Hey, on the document, I just wanted you left the N off of my last name. It just has Mundo, MUNDO. There's
Oh.
no.
Okay, on the document that links to your chapter.
Correct.
Okay, I'll fix that. Thank you.
You're welcome.
All righty. Just want to thank you so much for joining me today. Inquiring minds want to know, don't you? Yeah. Awesome. Awesome. I'm excited. So it's going to be just pretty much me talking. Hopefully I can get through this to leave room and time for everyone to contribute. And I definitely want contributions to the ideas that I'm going to share. I put on in the email, play devil's advocate for me and tell me the things that you don't think are going to work so that we can tweak them and work them and work out the kinks and possibly make it work or let it go, and maybe there's something better. So, of course, we are looking at race in the city, work, community, and protest in Cincinnati, 1820 to 1970, edited and compiled by Dr. Henry Louis Taylor, Jr. And I'd like to read about him. Dr. Taylor is professor, Department of Urban and Regional Planning at the University of Buffalo School of Architecture and Planning. His research focuses on a historical and contemporary analysis of distressed urban neighborhoods, social isolation, and race and class issues among people of color, especially African Americans and Latinos. And this is how you access my reading of the books on the YouTube channel. Race in the City chapters will bring this page up. Only now there are 13 in that playlist. I have added a video of, I believe that it was session two, it may be session one, with the Public Library of Cincinnati and Hamilton County. So that's over an hour long, and you're more than welcome to watch that as well. Please make this YouTube channel a universal virtual book club by leaving comments, asking questions in the comment section, replying to questions or comments. Just make it alive, make it viral, and that would be awesome. I think I'd get some money if you do that. Oh, that would be great. Okay, if you'd like to serve as a chapter champion, please get in contact with me. I always need chapter champions, and I am hoping and anticipating that our series, where we review one chapter a month or one chapter a week for various organizations, even schools. I've got one person that's trying to hook me up with St. Ursula School to present Race in the City chapter by chapter for those students there. So I will be needing chapter champions. Just one chapter is what we ask. And there's my contact information if you're interested in helping with that. Or if you would like us to present, we would appreciate that. And of course, if you've been here before, you know that this book explains, and I will try to do it in a review and summary type fashion, but the book explains why blacks are at the bottom of the share of net wealth of the United States households. We're the yellow line. Latinx is the red line, and blue is other, and then the green is the white population who hold the majority of the wealth. Employment. I feel that there are two things that are brought out in this book in particular that explain why we're at the bottom of the wealth gap. And number one is employment. And the person that really explains this beautifully is Dr. Nancy Berteau. Her chapter number five. So if you want to go specifically straight to the chapter one is a great introduction. I believe it's chapter two that talks
You
about
okay?
black leaders. Be
I got good balance.
sure to mute yourself, please, when you come in. Mute yourself. We hear somebody.
Was my husband falling?
Uh-oh. Thank you. Her chapter five, Structural Economic Change and Occupational Decline Among Black Workers in 19th Century Cincinnati. So I'm going to start with the information that she provides in chapter five and then bring it up to the present day. And I'm going to be doing a lot of reading. The historian Stephen J. Ross relates the following incident from the early months of the Civil War, when Cincinnati's river trade was severely disrupted and violence erupted amid the hardships of unemployment among dock workers. And this is a quote: "Screaming, 'Let's clear out the niggers!' Irish dock workers, angered by the attempts of black laborers to underbid them for jobs, initiated a two-day riot in July 1862, which left a trail of destruction that stretched from the city's docks into the black homes along the levee." In Cincinnati, throughout the late 19th century, 1860 to 1890, black labor force participation rates were higher than those for whites, 54.8% versus 47.2%. The higher labor force participation rates of blacks were due to a number of factors, most which centered around the lower earnings of their families. Blacks began work at a younger age, which related to their receiving fewer years of education. Black workers were financially unable to retire as early as whites. And I can attest to that right now. At the age of 68, I'm still working. More Black family members, especially women, were needed as workers in order to cover basic necessities. And it gives the reference there. And these are pages from her chapter. Page 132, you will find Black families' low earnings were especially sobering when their higher labor force participation rates are considered. In effect, they worked harder to earn less. Nevertheless, Blacks continue to be excluded from many occupations by a variety of barriers that included the written and unwritten policies of companies, trade unions, and city government, as well as racism of white employers and employees. In the public sector, Blacks were barred from city jobs such as public health inspector and firemen on the grounds that the public, as well as fellow employees, would object to taking orders from Blacks or working in close quarters with them. And that is, she gathered that information from area there. Page 127, and I do have some pictures. Analysis of occupational trends shows that while many white workers, especially artisans, experience job dislocation, white workers as a whole were able to take advantage of the new good jobs that were created by industrialization. Black workers, however, clearly occupied a deteriorating position in the labor force amid the dynamic economic shifts of the late 19th century, from 1860 to 1890. The more prestigious occupations that Black men and women had managed to enter, such as barber and teacher, became less important in the Black workforce, while the low status occupations of laborer and domestic servant increasingly dominated the occupational profile of Cincinnati's Blacks. The occupations that Blacks entered in greater and greater numbers were also the very occupations that whites were leaving for the better opportunities now available to them in the industrialized economy. And if you're familiar with research terminology, when she says here they became less important, that doesn't mean that they weren't important to Blacks, that they would have loved to have those jobs, but they became less predominant in the occupations that they were able to access at that point in time. Page 142. As the pace of industrialization accelerated in the 1870s and 1880s, mechanization was increasingly utilized and many jobs became more specialized. To save on labor costs, lower paid white women and children were increasingly employed in many manufacturing establishments. Blacks were rarely hired for these new factory jobs. And as I've said in the past, thus you've got your child labor laws coming into effect because white children were working rather than white men or Black men. So now looking at a report by Derek Hamilton, The Racial Composition of American Jobs. This is in 2006, and his work is based on the work of Barbara Bergman, 1971, her work. So reading here, his prescription for change, this is the crowding, occupational crowding. You find Blacks crowded into jobs that pay less. And Dr. Hamilton's prescription for change here is that labor market interventions, such as anti-discrimination laws, and affirmative action policies are still needed. Still needed, he says, in 2006. And must be strengthened, I add, and enforced to redress the systematic crowding of Blacks into low-wage jobs and exclusion from the high-wage jobs. Just going to share this, the racial unemployment gaps are widest from employees without college degrees. So you see blacks are the blue, whites or non-Hispanic white are the red. And this is the unemployment rate by level of education and race. So those with less than a high school degree, the gap is widest, but blacks still are the most unemployed in that area. High school, some college, and college. The gap narrows, but still, there are more unemployed blacks with college degrees than there are whites. Now we're coming up to the year 2020. Joint Economic Committee, Congressman Don Beyer, Vice Chair. The economic state of Black America in 2020. Discrimination and occupational segregation are significant causes of racial disparities. Field experiments have shown that resumes with typically Black-sounding names received significantly fewer callbacks for job interviews than those with white-sounding names, even when candidates had identical qualifications. And we just saw the chart about the education. Might have the same education, but you don't get the job. A meta-analysis of these experiments has shown almost no change in the level of hiring discrimination among Blacks over the past 25 years. So he's taking this back to 1995. But we know from the book and other information that we've seen that it goes even beyond that. There is also evidence of Black employment being concentrated, that's the crowding, concentrated in occupations that have a higher risk of unemployment, often because of automation. Black workers also are at higher risk of being the first fired in the event of an economic downturn. I just want to share this. And I forget what it's to right now. Oh yeah, Black. When we look at that terminology, Black being used, very often it is not just the American descendants of slaves, but Black Haitians, Black Nigerians, Black Zimbabweans, Black Jamaicans. So immigrants that are Black are often included in those statistics. And I just want to share this information, a list of Black billionaires. And let's flip it, try to flip it, to 2021. And of course, we're familiar with Oprah Winfrey. We're familiar with I can't pronounce his name, Kanye West, Jay-Z, Michael Jordan. Okay, we're familiar with them and we're grateful for their advancement. But here is Black, a Nigerian, a billionaire, included in these numbers. Another Nigerian, a Zimbabwean. South Africa, no, Nigerian, a Nigerian billionaire. So when you hear talk about Blacks advancing or Blacks, it could be a Nigerian. And they did not suffer through slavery here in the United States. They may have suffered through trauma in their own countries. But they're not the ones that have my interest, at least at this point in time. Okay, so when we look at that yellow line, although it's Black and it's very low on that share of net worth, it may include Michael Jordan. Why not? And yet it is still that low. Also something to consider. This was a study of black immigrants that they earn more than US-born blacks. And this was done in 2015, so I'm sure that the information has changed. And then let me see if I can pull up my laser. Oh, where is my cursor? I hate it when it does that. Well, I'm going to talk about this screen and then move on to the next. And I don't think that I can get back. I may not get back. So rather than click the screen and go forward, we'll look at this. Okay. So you got your, and I can't find my laser pointer, so I can't point out. Ah, there it is. Okay, let me get my laser pointer while I'm here. There's my laser pointer, and let's see if I can go back. Okay, so this is black immigrants in 2013. So this is really rather old, and I'm sure the numbers have changed drastically, but we have black immigrants coming from various countries. Ethiopia, it looks like the majority from Jamaica. And again, this is 2013, so those numbers may have changed. But we've got to open up our heads to what may be considered when we're talking about blackness. Okay, so households become income. Let's see, I can't bring that down. For blacks is lower than Americans overall, but higher than U.S. born blacks. And this again is 2013. So here your black immigrants' household income of 43,800, but US born blacks is 33,500, almost $10,000 less. 10,000, yeah, dollars less. I'm not great with numbers, folks. And then among your black immigrants, you have your Africans, Caribbeans, Central Americans, and South Americans. Just something to keep in mind when we talk about black in the United States. And here, one in five black immigrants. I cannot read that. This thing is over it. Ah, there it is. One in five black immigrants live below the poverty line in 2013. Okay? So, black immigrants, 20% living below the poverty line. But US born blacks, these are your American descendants of slaves, not immigrants. US born blacks, 28%. And then again, where these black immigrants are coming from. And I'm just bringing this up because we're going to see it again as I go a little bit further. When you look at the average wealth by race and year of whites compared to Asian Americans, they are running neck and neck. This is again is 2013, so these numbers may have changed, but I don't think significantly. Just keep that in mind as we move forward. All right. The Cincinnati Symphony appoints its first chief diversity and inclusion officer. The Ohio-based orchestra announced that Harold Brown will take on the role effective March the 17th. He lives in the Glendale area. Great, I think that's awesome. However, I believe that it is a delay tactic. And I shared this article before, I'll try to bring it up again. Activist investors are pressing corporations to make public their EEO-1 data. This document contains the racial demographics of the company. Companies with 100 or more employees must submit the EEO-1 annually to the Equal Employment Opportunity Commission. The data is confidential, however, and companies are not required to publicly release it, with some arguing it does not accurately capture the structure of their businesses. Many executives have pledged to champion equality in response to the Black Lives Matter demonstrations across the United States and beyond. And we're just going to take a glimpse at Indeed.com. I just want to show you. Okay, I've got to change this laser pointer. It's not functioning. Okay, there we go. Indeed.com. And this is current. I don't. Okay, there it is, March the 25th. This
We
is.
can't see it.
You can't see it. Okay, I'm going to stop share. Thank you so much. Please chime in when you can't see something. Thank you. Are you seeing that now?
Yes.
All right. This public school is looking for a director of diversity, equity, and inclusion. King County, Seattle, Washington, it's looking for a senior equity, inclusion, and belonging manager. The YWCA in New York, Center for Racial Equity, senior diversity and inclusion consultant, senior education trainer, diversity, equity, and inclusion, diversity, equity, and inclusion, diversity strategic initiatives. Diversity, 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 and it just goes on and on and on. Of course, I have, this isn't just all that's on in Indeed.com. I searched for these, but I think we will find these coming up more and more and more. Let me go back to where I was. And it is because of this. Can you see this? You probably can't. The heat's on. Corporate America to reveal racial diversity data. This is an article from Reuters. Reuters. Are you seeing this?
No.
Okay, I will stop share. Go back. It's that simple, folks. I'm getting the hang of this thing here. Okay, so the heat's on corporate America to reveal their racial diversity data. And again, I say this is Reuters, from Reuters. And I'm not going to read it all. If you want, I can give you the link to the article, but it discusses the 100 employees, how they already have to submit demographic information. But activist investors are people that invest in these companies, and they are demanding that these companies show this data to prove that they are employing blacks, that they are employing people of color. Okay, so the heat is on. I'm going to go out of this, and for that reason. I believe that we're seeing that Indeed.com, these various positions coming up. I say that it's a delay tactic. I believe that come, and I hope it's not. Don't take me wrong. I hope it's not. But I see it as a delay tactic to give these companies time to beef up their diversity in their company. Say, well, we've hired somebody to do this. We've hired somebody, and it's great. They probably hired a black person or they probably hired a person of color. But until I see more blacks employed, I'm leery. I'm leery. And I'd love to see that data. And thanks to my daughter who works for the Food and Drug Administration. She shared this information with me. She is at the Center for Veterinary Medicine. I hope I don't get her in trouble. But you can see here, blue is white, the gold is Hispanic, gray is black or African American. Remember that, black or African American. The rust is Asian or Pacific and Islander. And then that green, I think you only see it a little bit there. Those are your American Indian Alaskan natives. And you will note that the pay grade increases as we go up. And you can see where blacks, you can see the number. And of course, I'm honing in on Black and African American. That's my focal point. That's who I am. That's what this is about. Okay? There's certainly a concern for Asians and Hispanic, but my concern is for American descendants of slaves. And this is where we are. And again, you can see even in the federal government, we are crowded into the lowest paying positions. It's still going on in our government. And whites get the biggest part of the pie. The higher the payment, the higher the your pay scale, the more. And this is phenomenal, isn't it? SES is Senior Executive Service. Title 42, I'm not sure what it is, but I know that it starts at 155,000 a year. Interesting. This is where we go back to that chart that I showed where Asian Americans are running neck and neck with whites when it comes to income, when it comes to wealth. Look at where they are. And I'm not saying anything negative. Please don't get me wrong. I'm just stating the facts. I'm just showing you what it is. Okay? And I would dare to assume that the blacks in this area are not American descendants of slaves, but are immigrants, black immigrants. And I could be wrong. I don't have that data, and I'm sure that they're not going to share it with me. This area, SBRS, Senior Biomedical Research Service. These are scientists. Need I say more? Oh, it's not going to activate. Remember this, folks, when you're given a presentation. Okay, so this is my real simple. It's really very simple. This is my idea. We need an outside agency. We don't need a director of diversity, equity, and inclusion, a director, a senior vice president of this company to do this work. We don't want somebody that's in bed with this man. We want an outside agency who streams a pool of American descendants of slavery talent to their HR. There needs to be a partnership where HR makes this person, this agency, privy to all openings, not just low pay scale openings, but all openings. So we're going to need to have some power behind this, some enforcement, federal, local, state enforcement, that these people are working together to pour more, to pool, pour more qualified blacks into positions, and not necessarily not all in from college graduates, but trades, wherever, whatever the need is, whatever the job opening is, she connects with this person to pull in your American descendants of slave. The company, however, should provide a mentor to hold this person's hand. If this mentor situation does not work out, then we go back to this agency. If legal help is needed, whatever is needed, then this person. Also, this person, I didn't mean to go there. This person stays on top of the new hire to be sure that this new hire does not slip through the cracks. How many times have we heard that? That they slip through the cracks, they've got a job, and then all of a sudden they don't. Well, what happened? So this person is in connection with HR. If anything happens, if there's a problem, if he's missing too much work, whatever it is, we want to nip it in the bud because we have to hold the hands of these new hires. because they are moving into an environment and into a world with which they are unfamiliar, and more than likely they do not have a friend or a relative who is familiar with this world. So they need assistance. Housing is the next problem. What does my time look like? Oh my goodness. Okay, housing, that's our next issue. And I'd just like to read what Dr. Taylor says here. There is a term, structural racism, which centers on the idea that discrimination is built into institutions and culture. Henry Louis Taylor Jr., a professor of urban and regional planning at the University at Buffalo and the founding director of the Center for Urban Studies there, has taken that idea of built-in racism a step farther. He argues that racism in the metropolitan U.S. is physically part of the landscape, both in the built environment and the market-centric economic network. I'd love to have him come and talk about that. So this is where we come from. Ohio became a state in 1803-02, I believe. In 1804, 1 year after Ohio becomes a state, the legislature adopts the Black Codes, a set of laws aimed at stemming the flow of freed slaves into the new state. The laws forced blacks entering the state to pay a $500 bond guaranteeing good behavior and to produce court papers proving that they were free for free. The laws were little enforced in northern Ohio, but were rigidly enforced in Cincinnati. These were our living conditions. And then came transportation, and we were able to move out of that basin. Not we, I can't include myself in that, but as Cincinnati expanded in land and in the ability to move away from the basin, so those who could afford to did. And this is on page 175. Marquette, Stegner, Alfred Bettman, and other housing reformers were particularly concerned that low-income black settlements, such as the communities in College Hill, Laughlin and Hazelwood, would lead to slums forming in the suburbs. We find developing just outside the corporation lines potential slums which will eventually contain all of the bad conditions we are fighting against now. That was Bleecker Marquette. A central goal of the housing reformers was to confine low-income black workers in the basin by using building codes, zoning laws, subdivision regulations, and comprehensive city planning to outlaw cheap housing in other parts of Cincinnati and Hamilton County. Simultaneously, they planned to encourage higher income whites to move out of the basin so that their old houses could trickle down to the blacks. This is pages 50 and 51 of the Cincinnati City Plan, year 1925. And I'm holding it here because I can't read it, but let me get my laser pointer. It's about in here on page 52. Maybe I can read it here. Therefore, it is obvious, and please, I've got the whole thing if you want to read it. Therefore, it is obvious that new houses cannot be built directly for wage earners, and that the only way housing accommodations can be provided for them is by relieving the pressure higher up. In other words, as fast as the families in better circumstances move out of the older tenements and houses, they will become available for housing the lower wage earners. This means that it is not feasible now to give any consideration as a part of the city plan to providing housing for low-wage earners, and that attention should be concentrated now on the amelioration of living conditions in the older parts of the town by zoning protection and by the provision of parks, playgrounds, community centers, and open spaces. The Model Homes Company is now remodeling abandoned buildings such as the old Good Samaritan Hospital for living purposes. Other enterprises of this sort might well be undertaken. Okay. So this is the plan. This is the plan. The city plan. We're not going to provide any housing for the low wage earners, which are going to be predominantly black. They're the ones that aren't making enough money on their jobs to move out of the basin. Well, we'll give them some parks. Not only that, the few that did try to move out of the basin, here is an article. I can't read that. That's too small. June something, 1944. Oh, there it is. No. African American families moving into previously all-white neighborhoods were met with violence in the post-war years. So that's what, 40 something. In several neighborhoods, including Mount Adams, Evanston, and Avondale. So this happened in Mount Adams. The police were called in. They didn't do too much. The two black families moved into the lower level of this house, and it was stoned by a mob of whites. A white woman in the community spoke up against what the white mob did, and they came back the next day, I believe it was, to hang an effigy of her in the neighborhood. Not only that, we've got our redlining. So this is just an image of what we would look at in 1957 when we were looking for a house. And Evanston is highlighted in, I have highlighted it in green. And sometimes they would say unrestricted. Can't see any of that. Unrestricted or the colored man's dream or for a colored man only. And here we've got a living room, two bedrooms, a bath, and a kitchen for $12,900. Oh, wouldn't you love that? That's in Evanston. In Loveland, you've got a five-room house and a bath for $12,500. We were restricted to a community that was declining. Had we been able to move into a house for $400 less in Loveland, I wonder what kind of equity we would have in that house today. Home ownership rate for African American alone by state. The highest that I could find were Mississippi, 54% black. South Carolina 51 and Wyoming 53. Everything else that I found was lower. Home ownership rates for African Americans. Ohio 35%. Cincinnati American Descendants of Slaves ownership, home ownership plan. In response to the announcement about the city's plans for spending the $291 million stimulus funds, I submitted the following letter to the council members, Landsman and Kearney. I think I may also have contacted, I'm sorry, it seems to me that I also contacted Mann, Mayor. Councilman Mann. And let me see if I can share the letter. Okay. Thank you for extending an invitation to the public to voice our opinions about the spending of Cincinnati's $291 million stimulus funds. The use of stimulus funds for the following items pales in comparison to Cincinnati's need for housing. And I quote from Cincinnati.com article, every year the city of Cincinnati loses up to 300 units of affordable housing to urban renewal or gentrification. So I'm not going to read them all, but this is the amount of money that they were planning to spend to improve outdoor facilities, expand trails, Schnell Riverfront Park, Osis Bicycle, Oasis, convert Vine and 8th 9th Street to a two-way street, new streetscapes on Central Parkway. These investments, and this is a quote from the article that I pulled this from, these investments will initially create construction jobs and economic activity to directly address the negative impacts of COVID-19 and will provide long-term public benefits for generations of city residents. I said in bold here, if blacks are overlooked and crowded out of construction jobs, as has been the case, then this means absolutely nothing to me. Construction jobs. The funds considered for the items listed above, as well as these below, should be used for low-income housing projects that will benefit Cincinnati's African-American population, the population most negatively impacted by urban renewal and gentrification. So these items were being directed toward neighborhoods, neighborhood activation fund. I changed this and highlighted it from affordable income housing to low income housing. And here, whatever that was, $5 million for the port of Greater Cincinnati, wanted to change that from affordable to low income. They wanted to demolish blighted structures. I'm saying rehab blighted structures. I would like to see this money used to fund the low-income housing project, which includes the following. And this is my idea. So I say here, rehab the homes of the oldest black residents who have lived in a currently gentrifying community for the longest amount of time. So Sally May is 87 years old. Lived in Evanston for 29 years. That would be the first. Upon the exit of that senior, be it to a nursing facility or death, these, what I call legacy homes, would belong to the community to rent for 10 years on a sliding scale to a qualifying, and I'm using the criteria of Habitat for Humanity, a black first-time homeowner, and I mean by black, I mean ADOS, I mean American Descendants of Slaves. After 10 years of homeowner and money management education and meeting all the responsibilities and obligations of the agreement with the community, the renter would then become the owner of that property. This program integrates the community. So rather than gentrify and displace all of the blacks, it integrates the community. It allows black children, black families to enjoy the benefits of a gentrified community. And it provides a transfer of wealth for future generations. And I say again, after 10 years of home ownership, and we're looking at various possibilities that there's a mortgage on the home, a reverse mortgage on the home, a lien on the home, or it may be free and clear. But regardless, for 10 years, this applicant who is renting for 10 years is paying down that mortgage or lien or just paying based on their income on a sliding scale to rent until they own. Not hearing that. And please be sure to put yourself on mute for me. Thank you so much. I'm trying to get back. to share. Okay. We're almost done here, and I'm eager to hear what you have to say. So, this is sort of a diagram of what it looks like. You got your blighted home that rather than be abolished or demolished, this is a legacy home. And poor Sally Mae is aged. She is the legacy homeowner, and she is under the burden of this home. Rehab this home. Use those funds to rehab this home. Now Sally Mae can end her years out in a beautiful home, and she has earned that. She deserves it. She's lived in this community, raised her children, and done the very best that she can on her limited earnings and now her fixed income, and she deserves that. Upon her exit, however that may be, we will bring in a young family. This is the legacy heir. She can suggest an heir, but they would have to qualify based on the criteria. They would become the legacy renter for 10 years. And after the 10 years, they own the home, no mortgage. They can put money into their children's education, whatever, into a business, whatever they choose. They do not have the burden of a mortgage. And if I may, I'm going to stop share. Let me see. Maybe I should. Maybe I should. We'll see.
You can forget having to go on a restrictive calorie counting diet
Are
ever
you
again.
seeing this?
You
Are
never
you
have to
hearing
do another
this?
second of
Not seen.
Not
Martin Luther
seen.
King. We had a conversation a couple days ago.
Okay. All righty. Okay, I'm going to try to share this. I think this is really important that we see it. Okay, now are you seeing it?
Go
Yes.
about
Are you
handouts
hearing it?
Yes. Yes.
and how these right-wing memes, these Republican memes, have infiltrated the Democratic debate to suggest that, ending welfare as we know it, all those kind of things are somehow, great and noble things, when we're not dealing with the underlying problem, which is that there's no economic opportunity there. Because of insane trade policies and because of Reaganomics. And Martin Luther King spoke to this. Jim and Shane, this is clip number four. Martin Luther King spoke to this sometime back in the early 60s. And I thought this was a really interesting quote. Here he is.
At the very same time that America refused to give the Negro any land, through an act of Congress, our government was giving away millions of acres of land in the West and the Midwest, which meant that it was willing to undergird its white peasants from Europe with an economic floor. But not only did they give the land, they built land-grant colleges with government money to teach them how to farm. Not only that, they provided county agents to further their expertise in farming. Not only that, they provided low interest rates in order that they could mechanize their farms. Not only that, today many of these people are receiving millions of dollars in federal subsidies not to farm, and they are the very people telling the black man that he ought to lift himself by his own bootstraps. Now, this is what we are faced with, and this is the reality. Now, when we come to Washington, in this campaign, we are coming to get our check.
From his speech, The Two Nations of Black America, and it's absolutely brilliant. And the next time some white person talks about, well, I pulled myself up by my bootstraps and my family did too, especially the Bundy boys. I mean, you know, here's Martin Luther King, the Reverend Dr. Martin Luther King Jr., talking about how basically whites stole the West from the Indians with the and didn't just steal it. I mean, murdered the Indians in the process, and did not give any of these benefits to African Americans for 100 years in this country. You know, it's a strong case for reparations or some variation on it, for rebuilding our cities, for doing right after having done wrong for so many centuries. It is a very, very strong case for that. To watch more clips from our programs, hit the Watch More.
Okay. I had no idea that it was going to take all this time. But I want to open up the floor for any discussion, any thoughts, any contributions, criticisms of what I presented.
This is Dana. I just first off want to applaud you for putting together a plan or an idea, at least of what to do with these funds. It's seems like the $5 million is pretty low. I mean, it seems like the priority should be more to under building up the area that you suggest. I think it's a real interesting plan. It sounds like you're working with an economist.
I've spoken with Duke University economist William Darity. Mm-hmm. And I'm not communicating with him. We're not back and forth, but I just present, and he was kind enough to speak with me. Mm-hmm. I just presented this idea to him, and he said, go for it. It sounded good to him.
Yeah, I think it's great. I just kind of wanted to add another thing, like as a white person trying to understand a lot of the background and history. I've been married to a Black woman, almost 10 years, Caribbean background. But she was saying a couple weeks ago, it like takes a white person at least 10 years of study and material like this to get it, to be open to these ideas. And instead of having this reactionary kind of white grievance approach, which is really easy to inflame, we've seen that. Again, I don't have any answers, but that makes sense to me. I applaud your efforts trying to educate people to be open to these ideas, understanding the past.
Thank you.
That's the challenge, is combating this white grievance mindset.
Thank you, Dana.
I think two of the things that I think that you said, I think your plan is brilliant. And definitely needed, but I think we need to hear more, not from you necessarily, but as a community and as a country, we need to hear more of the term American dependent of slaves, descendants of slaves, as separate from other categories of Blacks, and begin to do the work Dana said, you know, to educate white people about how we have benefited from things that others were not allowed to benefit from. And the other thing I love in your plan is the low income housing. I hate this affordable housing because it's never affordable for people who need it. It's affordable, they think, but they're not the people who use that term with the developers and to try to sell these projects. It's not what we need. We need housing that's possible for low-income workers and people who can't get a job. They still need a house, mm-hmm. still need a place to live.
Thank you, Cynthia.
Hi, this is April. So based on the plan that they were originally communicating and was it about the infrastructure? Was the city saying we should, you know, rehab, like do parks and all these other things? Is that what this? Yeah. And that makes sense for them if they want to help the regentrification process. it in no way, if they try to tag on, we'll have, blacks or other people help to build these things, but they're essentially building the infrastructure for gentrification to continue on, because it's not really helping them. It's just making the environment beautiful and desirable for those individuals who are going to come in and try to take the homes anyway. So focusing the direction and the rehab and the conversion of those houses to other Black individuals, that is a more sustainable plan that will help Black families. And what you're saying as far as taking those benefits and then being able to reap the benefits of being in a gentrified area is going to be better school opportunities. It's going to be better educational and better healthcare opportunities. It's going to open them up to circles and environments and networks that will be able to provide better jobs. So absolutely, I think your plan is much more compatible to the needs of Black people, especially Black low-income people who have no way to build wealth because they are trapped in the rental, the rental world, or, in housing that they cannot afford. So I think it's fantastic. And I think the more people understand, and thank you so much for showing that video of Martin Luther King, because I feel like this country is like, they're dazed and confused, right? I feel like they see Martin Luther King, they see his image, they see, the fight that he had, nonviolence and all this stuff, but they don't see that side of Dr. King.
Right.
Most white people don't know that Dr. King, the Dr. King that was involved with the, COINTELPRO. That's it. They don't know, I'm just saying
the surveillance.
Yes. Of, them going after Dr. King and other prominent, Black messiahs. Right. So anyway, I think it's very important that people, and I love Tom Horton. He's just amazing. And I think it's such a great message that he's saying, this is the other side of it. And this is the realness of it. And I think until people are educated, our friends are saying, until they are educated about the realness of the atrocities and the problems that we've seen and dealt with, they won't know, because ignorance has been bliss up to that point. And even with MLK talking about the farmers, there were Black families who were farmers. And then all of those people were pushed out of farming. And it wasn't until the Obama era that they actually were able to start getting a fraction of the money in reparations for having their farms taken away. I mean, this is all real everyday stuff. So while other people are benefiting, even us trying to get a piece of that is rejected in some way, form, or fashion through policy and through, government assistance of making laws that prevent us from getting the grants and getting the money that we need equitably. So thank you for this. Thank you for this talk and for the entire series.
Thank you. Anybody else?
Well, I'd like to thank you for this entire series and this recap today, and to even take it one step further. I don't live in the city of Cincinnati. I live in Hamilton County, but not in the city of Cincinnati. But when working with city council, dealing with the stimulus money for sure and getting it kind of moving in the right direction, and even going further, because, even though they say on the front end, they come in and develop an area like they did for the soccer stadium, and they ended up displacing so many people. Mm-hmm. I mean, it absolutely ought to be that our city plan is, if a developer comes in to do this type of project that you are suggesting, that they figure out how to get them involved in that. So it's not just one time we've got stimulus money, we're going to try to do this, but it's going further every time somebody comes in and tries to gentrify or wipe out communities or keep pushing people into communities that aren't taken care of, that there just is a line in the sand that says, no, you can't do this. There has to be a certain amount of money that the city's going to get, and that's going to go towards giving people that housing opportunity to build that wealth through that mechanism. And again, you know, if they can be in areas where they're in good school districts and in all of that, you know, then fine. But, you know, it's a big puzzle, but I actually think you've got a great idea. And one step further is to make sure that from here on out, it's thought of in that way, not just a little bit of stimulus money right now or infrastructure money when it comes, you know, that kind of thing. So thank you very much. And we'll support you however we can.
Thank you, Diane. Thank you so much. I believe that Greg Landsman is working on some kind of development legislation to see that developers do have more buy-in. I don't know to what extent that goes, but I do think that they're thinking in that direction. I know I did not share this, but my thought is beyond the stimulus money, that those 3CDC, I think you all heard of 3CDC, and those that have developed the downtown area, gentrified it, etc., and basically our Fortune 500 companies right here in the city of Cincinnati that call Cincinnati home. The money that they donate yearly to third world countries, it should go to the city in which they're doing their business. We are a people. We live as a third world people. African Americans in the United States of America live as a third world people in the richest country in the world. So rather than send that money to Haiti and Jamaica, I mean, I love them. But as I said, I am self-centered. It's about me right now. And we need this money here to make things right here.
And Melanie, I thank you for doing this. I know it takes a lot of time and well thought out, and I just appreciate all of your efforts. And I think about the men that work construction, and you had mentioned the employment. And I am just disheartened every time I drive down the street and I see no Black men working on the streets and making all of that good money. I know they're making good money in construction, but I never see any Blacks. And I think, you know, that should definitely be changed. Mm-hmm. And that structural racism, it somehow needs to be dismantled. I know it maybe took a long time to get it in the structure, but it somehow needs to be dismantled, because we are a third world country. You know, some of our neighborhoods are third world. And we do need that money for our neighborhoods, not for you big companies to benefit from giving the money as a tax write-off, but we need it right here for our people. So I thank you. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Cassie. Thank you so much. Well, everybody, we are past our time. I appreciate your participation, your feedback. I am just an email away. I think you all have my email address. So I'll stay in touch with you. Please stay in touch with me. Thanks so much, and God bless you all.
Thank you.
Thank you, Melanie.